Well, we're, how many of you guys heard of the Red Green Show? Men? Women too, okay. Men? This is the opening of the Red Green, the men's club that met in the hall there. What's the name of the hall there? The Moose Hall or something like that? Moose Lodge? I don't know what it was. At the lodge. All right, men, I'll stand up. You don't have to stand up, but repeat after me, men. I'm a man, and I can change. If I have to. Isn't that good? Oh, man. This would have been Jacob. We're talking about him today. Genesis 31 to 32. If you want to open your Bible there, it'll be up on the screen some of it. Jacob would have been the guy who said, I'm a man, and I'm not sure if I can change, because my name says I'm a deceiver manipulator. So when people in his language met him, it would have been like, hey, deceiver, hey, manipulator. Hi, liar, how are you doing today? Can you imagine if your worst flaw was also your name? Your character flaw was your name. Hey, greedy. Hey, late person. Hey, non-punctual person. Or hey, person who doesn't do a good job at their job or whatever. Whatever your name. That was your name. Can you imagine that? So this is Jacob, right? So here's a man. Now, if God can change Jacob, is there hope for you? Right? So one of the cool things about the entire Bible, from Old Testament characters, including Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all the way up to the disciples, is that we have lots of flawed characters, and none of us can say, oh, God can't do anything with me. I'm just a lost cause. Wow. Because God loves to take lost causes. He loves to take unlikely candidates. That's whom he chooses. Did you know that? There are very few characters. Even the man after God's own heart, David, had so many character flaws. Like, you can't trump David. I challenge you. He was a bad dad. He was an adulterer. He was a murderer, fornicator, polygamist. Did I say he was a terrible dad? Yeah, I mean, so, yeah, try and beat that. Maybe you think you got that beat. But no, still a man after God's own heart. So God says the irredeemable are redeemable. The lost causes are redeemable. We can claim. We can salvage anybody. Isn't that amazing? So there's hope for you today. So if some of this comes down hard on you, just remember that the nature of this, the spirit of this message today is hope that you can change. I'm a man, and I can change if I have to. Okay? Women, oh, I know, you just regularly respond to things and change quickly. It's just us men who are stubborn, so this message may not be for you. But it's based on one of the Beatitudes, and this is the fifth in our study, and it's this one. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness' sake. Now, righteousness has to do with justice, goodness. If you want justness in your life, you want to be a just person, a good person, a person in right relationship with God, with other people, with nature, with your surroundings, with your context, your community, then that's what we're talking about. But another way of viewing this, for the sake of our time together, let's just bring it down to this simple thing. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for spiritual health. Did you know that when Ann and I came here, our stated mission inside ourselves, like internally with Ann and I came to Mirror Alliance Church, the thing that we believed God was calling us to do and continue to believe is help a church family to be spiritually healthy. Spiritual health is a difficult thing to measure, isn't it? It's not measured by attendance numbers, not measured by, well, there's all kinds of things it's not measured by. We didn't come here to help people stop drinking, smoking, or chewing, or... Actually, did you ever hear the saying, I don't smoke, drink, or chew, or go with girls who do? Some of the older folks, more mature people, know what I'm talking about. There you go. That's for you, Connor. Don't smoke, drink, or chew, or go with girls who do. The point, those are the external things, right? We think, oh, there's this list of external things, and we check off the boxes, and I'm a righteous person. I'm a good person, right? No, spiritual health is different. That's why you never hear me preach sermons about stop drinking, smoking, or chewing. Because Jesus didn't talk about that stuff. Did he? Matter of fact, he was the one being accused of a glutton and a sinner because of the people he hung out with. Doesn't mean he was a glutton or a sinner. It just meant that he was associated with those, and he didn't focus on the externals. He was concerned about spiritual health, health on the inside. Matthew 5 to 7 is about healthy inside, right? He even said in Matthew 5 to 7, part of the Sermon on the Mount, hey, it's not about whether you physically murder someone, is do you hate them in your heart? Oh, whoa, whoa, that's inside stuff. That's spiritual health. And it's not about whether or not you commit physical adultery, it's do you commit adultery or lust in your heart? He's saying, I'm after spiritual health, not box checking some religious list. You see that? So Ann and I felt called, God, would you, you've called us to humbly encourage and nurture spiritual health, a culture of spiritual health. So that's partly what this is about. So blessed are those who hunger and thirst, who have a passion, desire, a drive for spiritual health. Okay. Specifically, we're going to talk about the Lake of Jacob because he is quite a case study. Man, we could spend weeks and weeks and weeks. And we're looking at Genesis 31 and 32, but you can go back chapters and chapters and go, whoa, Jacob is, I mean, he had a file open in child and family services, marriage counseling, RCMP. This guy was known to all authorities and in-laws and outlaws. Quite a guy. Wow. I mean, I just look at Jacob and think, God, if you can do something with this guy, there's so much hope for me. And I hope that's true for you. We're talking about five phases God uses to change us. I'm a man and I can change if I have to. By the way, the other part of it is, so I'm going to ask you, all of us, to repeat after me. Trust me, it'll be good. I'm not going to take you down the garden path, but if you're willing to say this, I am broken, but I can be healed if I will cooperate with God. Okay, so God has a recovery plan for you, but you have to cooperate with it. See where I'm going with this? Sometimes doctors and other people say, you got to work with the meds. In other words, you got to work with a plan. You got to cooperate, right? So it's one thing to say, hey, I got a new car. Really? And then it gets repossessed. And then your friend says, well, weren't you making payments? Oh, well, no, I didn't know how to do that. Oh, your friend says, no, you got to cooperate with the plan here. The cooperation part is you do the payment every month and you get to keep that car. So when it comes to God recovering us, changing us, transforming us, there's a role we play, and it's called cooperation. It's called working with his plan. Okay? It's a both and thing. It's not you do it all or God does it all. It's God's initiating and doing. I'm responding and cooperating. So we're going to look at the life of Jacob. When he did cooperate, when he didn't cooperate. Lessons from Jacob's struggles, and there are a bunch of them. So a bit of background to Jacob. Jacob was always in conflict. Matter of fact, earlier than you can imagine, unless you've read the story, Jacob's first conflict was coming out of the womb. He literally came out second, but he wanted to come out first. So Esau is his brother. Esau comes down the birth canal, and then here's Jacob holding on to Esau's foot. Can you imagine that? So from that moment on, it was like, that little manipulator, you little sneaky little, right? That's how he got his name, deceiver, manipulator, trying to get out first. Hey, you're not getting out first, it's me. Has that ever happened in calving? No. The twins, no. Anyways, it's a weird, by the way, this entire story is weird. Even the one we just read earlier from the wrestling with God thing, this entire thing, you can't make this stuff up. Like, this is quite something. You should read the rest of the Bible because it's even crazier. So he's already in conflict the moment he pops out, right? And it goes from bad to worse. He's conniving with his mom against his dad. He's tricking his brother out of an inheritance. He's manipulating his father-in-law, and as he's being manipulated by his father-in-law eventually, and he marries two wives. Well, come on, man, let's be honest. We struggle to do well enough with one wife, and this guy's having multiple. It's not going to go well. He didn't. So on and on and on and on, he's in conflict and struggle. He's struggling, struggling, struggling. He's in conflict. He's struggling with others. Everybody. So, newsflash. And by the way, God gets his attention eventually here by wrestling him, and we'll get into this a bit, but if everywhere you go, there are problems, God might be getting your attention. Yeah, I changed school 3 times and they kept failing me. Maybe it's not your teacher, your principal. Maybe God's trying to get your attention about something. Or every job, you know, my boss said, or every church I've been to, or every pastor, it's like, okay, whoa, time. Or if I was as a pastor, say, well, every church I've been to, the people are just the problem. Right? So eventually, people around us say, well, Dan, maybe God's trying to get your attention, because your last 3 spouses you said were really bad. And now you're complaining about your 4th. Could it be you? Could you be part of it? Oh, newsflash. Everywhere Jacob goes, he's got stuff. Wake up, Jacob. So eventually we'll get to that. Let's not get too far ahead. But he's in conflict with others. So let's look at one of those conflicts. So Jacob's father-in-law, Laban, Genesis 31. Jacob heard that Laban's sons were saying, so this is like his wives' brothers, are saying, Jacob has taken everything our father owned and has gained all his wealth from what belonged to our father. And Jacob noticed that Laban's attitude toward him was not what it had been. So now he's got problems with his brother-in-laws. He's got problems with his father-in-law. And by the way, partly is because he's thriving and nobody else likes it. He's doing really, really well at farming and livestock and everything. He's thriving. And God has his hand on blessing on this deceiver manipulator, even here. And so he's having these struggles with others, but he's in conflict. So it's not just his mom, it's not just his dad, it's not just his own brother Esau. He's got trouble everywhere. Everywhere he goes, there's conflict. This is the first stage, by the way, in our transformation. This is a choice that we're going to look at in just a moment. But conflict with others should be a clue that God is using in your life and in my life to say, hey, Dan, there's conflict going on everywhere you go. I'm trying to get your attention through this. Will you listen to me? That doesn't mean it's all my fault. That's not where this is going. This wasn't all Jacob's fault. But conflict is an opportunity for us to say, okay, God, you got my attention. Now what? What I want to do is blame. Oh, then blame. Blame, by the way, never accomplishes what we think it does. It never accomplishes positive life change in you. It actually turns you into a victim. And victimization never produces the kind of character qualities that you want in your life. You've been victimized. You've been a victim. But living a life of blame and victimization will never move you forward into life change, you or your family members. So, Genesis 32 now. The messengers return to Jacob. This is another context. So Jacob and Esau are at war. Jacob has to leave Laban, his father-in-law, and his whole family there because things are getting really heated up. So he's like, okay, I'm leaving. I'm taking all my stuff, all my people, all my wives, all my everything, and I'm going to travel. This couldn't have worked today because of fences. But back then, literally, you could just pick up and all of you just start traveling across open land. We're going to find new land. And he's like, well, I don't really have a place to go to. I guess I'll just go back to where my family grew up and where Esau is. But he's like, ooh, but Esau and I are like, man, we're having trouble, right? I haven't even seen him in a while. I don't know what's going to happen. So the messengers, he sends messengers ahead, say, hey, when we're going towards Esau, I just want to know everything's okay, right? Because it could be tense. The messengers returned to Jacob and said, we went to your brother Esau, and now he is coming to meet you. He's really excited. He's got an army of 400 men. he's really looking forward to seeing you. Jacob wasn't thrilled about the party coming. He said he was terrified at the news. So now he's terrified by his in-laws. He's terrified with his brother. He's having struggles. Everywhere he turns, he's got challenges. So in Genesis 32, 9 to 11, we see a kind of an epiphany, a moment, a come to Jesus moment, right? It's like a, whoa, wake up. Then Jacob prayed, oh God, oh Lord, I am unworthy of all the kindness and faithfulness you've shown me. He takes stock, he takes inventory and goes, man, I've got it good, really. Save me, I pray, for I am afraid. You ever been there? You ever been, you got to the end of your rope and you're like, okay, I've had conflict everywhere I go. I've got problems everywhere I go. I'm not the problem, but suddenly you're like, I don't have what it takes to solve this problem anymore. And that's where we come to choice number one, which we looked at in November. The reality choice. Reality choice, and by the way, this is the choice of every recovery group that I've ever heard of. Celebrate Recovery, AA, NA, any of them. Realize I'm not God. Admit I'm powerless to control my tendency to do the wrong thing, and my life is unmanageable. So he says, I can't do it anymore. All my wives, my livestock, my wealth, my credibility, my social network, whatever I have, whatever I thought I had, it ain't enough. I don't have what it takes. Let me ask you, have you gotten there yet? You're going to get there. If you want life change, if you want transformation, you have to get to this point where you say, I don't have it on my own. As long as you got it together and you can do it, pull yourself up by your bootstraps and don't need any Bibles, you know what I say to people? Go nuts. Go crazy. Good for you. More power to you. I'll wait around. God's going to wait around until you're ready to say, I need help. Till then, you can't help people who don't want help. Right? So you've got a friend, a neighbor, brother-in-law, sister, mom, or a child, and you're saying, oh, if they would only just, I'm trying to help them, but they back away. They've got to decide that they're powerless. Okay, so confession. I don't do this well. How about you? How about you? I don't do this well. I want to fix, solve, help. Come on, this is the right thing to do. Can't you see this? And what if I just did this for you? And then you could keep it going. And it's like, no, don't do it. Don't enable. So, confession. I struggle with this in other people's lives. I want to fix, solve. Because I think I know everything. Apparently, I think I know everything about everybody. But it's not true. But you and I need to admit, no, I don't have it all together. I need help. So, in our conflict, our struggle with others, this beatitude that we looked at in November related to this choice was God blesses those who realize their need for him. Do you realize your need for God? Do you daily declare your need for God? Say, God, I can't do today. I don't have what it takes. I just can't do it. I need you. Okay, that's the beatitude. Second, we go from conflict. So Jacob's in conflict with everybody. And then we get to crisis. So it's kind of like a second stage in God's transformation of us and our letting him change us, right? I'm a man, I can change if I have to, but first I'm going to go through some conflict, and then I'm going to get to a crisis, and I struggle with God. I struggle with God. So here's a bit more of the story here, okay? So Jacob got his family, so his family's now moving towards Esau. It says Jacob got them, part of the family, safely across the brook, called Jabbok or Jabbok, along with all of his possessions. But Jacob stayed behind and was left all alone in the camp. Now, this is really interesting because at one point he splits up his family and his livestock. And he's like, well, if they decimate this half, at least I've still got this half. How would you like to be the wife and the rest of the family, the livestock, on that vulnerable while he's on the safe side? Like, there's so many bizarre things about this story. So many dishonorable things. But here's a little bit of an interesting thing. So in Hebrew, Jacob's name is pronounced Jabbok. And the place that he's going to, actually it's not quite pronounced that way, but the creek is called Jabbok. He's called Jabbok, I think is what it is. And then wrestling with is called Jabbok. So there are three words, almost identical, just a different vowel or two. So this is a word play in Hebrew. All that's happening in these verses. So here's Jacob going to the brook of Jabbok, and then he's jabeking or wrestling with God, if you want to put it that way. So Jacob stayed behind and was left all alone in the camp, and a man came and wrestled with him until dawn. One of the most bizarre things in the whole Bible, but not the most bizarre. You really have to read the rest of the Bible. It's crazy stuff. So what you and I can learn from this is, one of the things we can learn from this is that your and my struggle is not actually with your ex, your mom, your mother-in-law, your child, your dad, the classmate, that teacher, your employer. You know what? Ultimately, we come to a crisis where we go, okay, God, it's you and me. You see, because you are the one that let me be in this place. You are the one who said you're going to make me into your image, and you took me through this crazy journey. See, eventually, religious people don't usually do this. It takes a while to get here, and I'll tell you why. Because we've been told we can't blame God for stuff because he's too holy and good and righteous, and so don't blame God if you have a problem. Okay, well, what are you left with then? If you're a blamer, you blame other people. You blame institutions. You blame systems. You blame some conspiracy. You blame, all so that you don't have to really come face to face with God and say, God, I'm really kind of frustrated and I'm angry with you because you have the power to change all these systems and these people and remove these bad people from my life and put good people in my life. So ultimately, you're responsible. Now, that may be misplaced blame, but you're coming to the right place when you do that. See where this is going? So God finally wrestles Jacob down and says, dude, it's not about all these other people. It's about you and me. Let's go now. Right? You ever read a Lululemora book like that? And it's like all these guys, and it's like, you, me, in the street, duel. Right? This is God saying to Jacob, look, you've done enough mess. You've messed up so much stuff in your life, so many relationships. Like, it's always been about you and me. Let's go. Let's get this done. Let's take it outside. Okay? Just saying, it was a wrestling match. Can't make this stuff up. See, you and I, my biggest conflict is not with everybody else. It's actually with God. And when we eventually come to that point, now God can do some transformation in us because we're dealing with him directly. We're not indirectly going all over the place. Nobody else can fix you. Only God can do that. Well, Genesis 22, 23 to 25, God's wrestling with him in the form of a man. By the way, God appears in the Old Testament as a man. There are Christophanies and Theophanies. These are appearances of God in the Old Testament, of God in the form of either the captain of the Lord's army or an angel or a man wrestling with Jacob. These are all Theophanies or Christophanies, appearances of God where we don't expect to see them, but they're there. They're all over the Old Testament. When the man, God in the flesh apparently, saw that he couldn't win the match, so this is interesting, in his human form, he doesn't take advantage of the God advantage and pin him down, right? He says, no, we're gonna do mano a mano, you know, man to man, just in human strength. And it actually says he couldn't win the match. So Jacob's some dude, right? Like he's had some training here, I don't know. So the man representing God here, apparently, strikes Jacob's hip and knocks it out of joint, out of the socket. Ouch. Right? So in wrestling, this is the pin down on the mat, right? This is getting on the mat. In MMA, it's tap out, right? It's like, okay. Okay, right? That's the picture here. It's either pinned down, right? I don't know. What do they do in legit Olympic wrestling? What does the ref do? Does they count or does somebody tap or? Thank you. Okay, there it is. So, but that's what's going on here. So Jacob's down. So the guy's like, I can't really, you know, take this guy out, but I'll find a way to pin him and or get him to tap out. So Jacob taps out, but there's something else going on in this whole picture. So in Hosea 12:3, there's a looking back. It's one of the minor prophets we may look at in the next few months. See, our real struggle is with God. It says, before Jacob was born, he struggled with his brother. Grabbed his ankle on the way out of the, you know, isn't that crazy? Struggled with, when he became a man, he even fought with God. Is that a badge of honor? Or it's like, dude, you should have cooperated before you got to that wrestling match. But it says, yeah, he was a fighter all the time. He was a conniver. He wrestled. He struggled. He even fought with God. Wow. So you and I want to be in control. But eventually we come to a crisis and we say, we're not in control. It's about you. I tap out. God is looking for you and I to tap out. We're pinned down and we say, I can't do it. I'm tired of struggling. You win. And then God says, okay, now we can get somewhere. See, and that's the hope choice. The hope choice is to earnestly believe that God exists, that I matter to him, and that he has the power to help me change. At that point, Jacob was ready to say, okay, I get it now. I'm beginning to get it. I'm beginning a process of recovery. You have the power to help me. Wow, that's a huge moment. Then we come to three, commitment. We talked about our conflict. We talked about a crisis that we come to often. Many of us need to come to a crisis point. And then we cross over into commitment. In other words, we're serious enough about change. I'm a man and I can change if I have to. Okay, I'll start the steps. I'll go to step one. I'll go to step two, step three. And that's what AA is about, by the way, or Celebrate Recovery step. You go through the steps. I commit to God's changes. I'm serious enough that I'm not going to waffle around. I'm not going to go back and forth. I'm ready to commit. I'm going to, you're an AA. I'm going to go to the meetings every week. I'm going to meet with my sponsor. Sorry if I talk a lot about this. You may not be familiar with that. Some of you know what I'm talking about when I talk about AA or recovery groups. It's about growing regularly. I know a guy who's been 25 years dry, hasn't drunk in 25 years. He goes to AA three times a week. And he's committed, partly because he's helping other people who need that. And so I don't know how many chips or pins or coins he has, but can you imagine after that many years of sticking with it? He knows his weakness. He knows where he can go. And so he says, I'm so committed. He doesn't brag about it. I've had to ask him about it. Yeah, I go three times a week, three different groups. And I encourage other people. I cheerlead them because we're in this together. Isn't that amazing? By the way, that doesn't mean he's weak. That doesn't mean he's depending on it like a crutch. He loves Jesus and knows Jesus saved him, but he needs his group. He needs his mentor, and he needs to sponsor somebody else. So we commit to God's changes. So in Genesis 32:26, it says, then the man, God, who's wrestling with Jacob, the man said, let me go, for it's dawn. So he's clinging on to him so tight, even though his hip's displaced. He's hanging on to this guy who's been wrestling with. And the guy says, let me go, for it's dawn. We've been wrestling all night. Come on, we're tired. Jacob's panting. Can you imagine wrestling all night? I can't. I won't let you go unless you bless me. Okay, you want to talk about passion and commitment to it? I talk about three AA meetings a week. But for some of us, it means ruthless discipline on a daily basis. Spiritual discipline, spiritual practices. We meet with Jesus in the morning. We say, Jesus, I can't even make it through the first hour. I commit myself to you. I'm a living sacrifice. Everything about me I give to you. And then at noon, we have to pray it again. Oh, God, I'm struggling here. So discipline, passion, it's involved. This is not easy stuff, recovery. And he says, I'm hanging on to you, and I won't let you go unless you bless me. This is hard to understand. We don't function in a blessing environment. That's not our culture so much. But that's how committed. That's how much he's hanging on for dear life to the one who can make the biggest difference in his life. So that leads us to number three, the commitment choice. And we covered this about a month ago, or a bit more. Consciously choose to commit all my life and will to Christ's care and control. Choose to commit my life and will to Christ's care and control. Wow. See, recovery is a long haul. So if you came up to me after the service and say, Pastor, pray that I'd be able to overcome this thing this week. And when I say, okay, well, how long you had this thing? Well, about 22 years. And I might say, yeah, I'll pray for healing for you. But it could take you 22 years of investing in spiritual disciplines to totally whip this thing. Can we walk together through those? Maybe at least 5 years or at least 8 weeks to build a habit? You see what I'm saying? See, we want the magic pill. We want to, in some circles, they talk about the fire tunnel. Some Pentecostal. And so they have a bunch of people lined up with hands over this way and hands over the other way. And they pray for people as they walk through. And they speak blessing over them. And some of you have maybe experienced this. And I don't devalue that. But if you think that some kind of magic wand or a fire tunnel is going to bring healing from everything that you've ever done or experienced, I'm going to just say that's less faith, more naivety. Generally speaking, yes, God can heal you in a moment. But a lot of alcoholics have to go to AA for a long time. A A lot of abusers have to go through lots of therapy. A lot of people who are victimized by trauma, it takes years of Jesus healing and therapists working with you, learning new habits, learning new thinking patterns, cognitive behavioral therapy where you're changing your thinking and telling yourself the truth. See, these are processes. These are long-term things. So we're committed, but it takes commitment. It takes grabbing onto God and saying, I'm going to hang in there. You're not going to let go of me. You're committed to my transformation, but I'm committed to the process. So don't tell me, well, Pastor, you prayed for me and it didn't work. Say, well, it's not about me working or my magic prayer. It's about cooperating with what God's doing in your life. God wants you to get off of an addiction or a substance or whatever your hang-up is or hurt or habit. Then we're going to have to journey together to change those habits. Wow, you see, recovery is hard work. Yes, God's doing it, but we cooperate with that recovery, that transformation. So let's keep going. Paul says in Romans 6 this, do not let any part of your body become a tool of wickedness to be used for sinning. Instead, give yourselves completely to God. So there's a giving ourselves to God. Romans 12 talks about living sacrifice, putting ourselves on the altar before God. And use your whole body as a tool to do what is right for the glory of God. So there's discipline, there's yielding, there's putting things in front of God and saying, these are yours, I need you. So that leads to the number four stage, confession. So we've gone all through this conflict. What did I say? Crisis. And then what did I say? I'm testing you. Were you listening? Come on. I don't remember my notes. I'm testing you to see if you do. Commitment. Right? So conflict can lead to a crisis, but it can also give us the opportunity to commit. Right? To commit to God's changes. But now, confession's a part of it. Confession is admitting I'm the problem or I'm a part of the problem. Right? You know, we all complain about politicians, but one of my favorite songs by a group called Switchfoot is from a long time ago. It's about 20 years old now, but it's called I Am the Politician, or We Are the Politicians. So the point is, it's not them, there, that prime minister, that premier, that. No, I'm the guy. So I think it was G.K. Chesterton wrote into like the London Daily News or the Daily Mirror or something like that. And a question was posed, what is the main problem in society? Does anybody know what he wrote into a letter to the editor? What did he say in his letter? I am. Oh, wow. Are you prepared to do that? Am I prepared to do that? See, when somebody in our community says, you know what I don't like about church? And then they say something, my opportunity is to throw the entire church under the bus, or you, or somebody who used to attend our church, or to say, yeah, I'm sorry, I'm the problem, I'm part of that problem. Will you accept at least my apology that I'm part of that? I've been a hypocrite. Sometimes I gossip, and I apologize for that because I'm not representing Jesus well. I had a conversation in a lunchroom last week with two people who they haven't been to church in years, and they told me why. I didn't ask. It wasn't even the conversation, it just led into it, and all of a sudden they're telling me about why they don't go to church. And I said, you know, we're trying to build a church culture in Mirror Alliance Church where it's under new management. Guess what the new management is? Jesus. Not me, not you, not some family, not a clan, not you, not the biggest tither, not the biggest attender, not the most consistent, whatever. None of us get to be that. Only Jesus gets to be king. So we say, well, what did Jesus do? What would Jesus say? How would Jesus respond to that? Love God, love others. Kind of simple. We're the problem. Jesus isn't the problem. And by the way, in that conversation, I said, we're trying to move more like Jesus. So when people do things like you're describing people and religious people do, I said, I try to point them towards how could we be more like Jesus? Because Jesus didn't do those things. So why am I doing them if I say I want to be like Jesus? So I said, yeah, I'm a hypocrite. We're hypocrites. We're admitting that we would like to be like Jesus. We're aspirationally committed to those things. We want to be that, but we're not yet. But let's try to be like that. I'm not saying that satisfied these people who were talking about it. But I'm part of the problem because the church is full of humans. I'm one of them. and therefore, so I have to admit that. I have to come to the place where I'm okay with that. It's okay that you're not okay. You're part of the problem. So the man asked Jacob, moving on a bit more here, what's your name? No, he knew his name, but he says, manipulator, deceiver, liar. He says, that's my name. And the man said, really? Oh, I would have never known that. I'm shocked. No, he was like, yeah, I knew that, but now you're saying it. Okay, I admit I'm part of the problem. Jacob's like, hey, I just want to fess up. I'm a deceiver and manipulator. And the guy's like, yeah, I know. But I got you to say it, though. Wow. Wow. What if I was ready to say, I'm the one who talks too much. I'm the one who talks first and listens later. I'm the one who, I should be listening first and speaking later, but I speak first and listen later. Yeah, I'm that guy. Well, maybe then God's got space to work in me once I admit that. And that leads to the house cleaning choice, or that the house cleaning choice is the beatitude around this thing. I openly examine and confess my faults to myself, to God, and to someone I trust. So if you want to be forgiven, tell God. If you want to be transformed, tell someone else. That's not heresy. Don't burn me at the stake. Just listen carefully. If I steal something from your farm, and I say, God, I'm sorry, will you forgive me for stealing that tractor from Greg's farm? Will I be forgiven by God? Yeah. Will it stop me from stealing something else from his yard? No. But if I go tell Greg, I told God about this, and I was wrong, I stole your tractor, and he says, okay, so pay up or bring it back and repair it and whatever. Okay, I've done restitution, I've been transparent, I've confessed. Now Greg's got eyes in his camera when he sees my vehicle come into the yard. He's like, I used to just say, hey, a friend's coming over, and now I'm like, maybe I should watch what goes out in that vehicle when it leaves my farm. So I'm on notice now, right? So there's some accountability. He's now my partner in helping me deal with my sin and change and transform. He's my partner. His camera on me is helpful, not hurtful. He wants to prevent me from going down that road. He wants to help me. So by confessing to him, I actually become a changed person potentially. Right? So it's not Catholics or Baptists or Alliance that go to confession and we think, oh, that's so cheap. No, we do it all the time. We confess to God, but not to someone else. And James 5:16 says, confess your sins one to another, and you'll be healed. Healed, transformed, changed. So, number five stage, last stage, conversion. In other words, we've gone through crisis. Sorry? Conflict. A conflict, crisis, commitment. And then? Confession. And then it leads to conversion. We often think, I am talking about conversion. I'm talking about people who, for the very first time, come face to face with God, have a transformational experience, their sins are forgiven, their destiny is changed. I am meaning that when I say conversion. And I get a new identity. See, you and I get a new identity, and this is the exciting thing. Remember I said, I'm a man, I can change if I have to. In other words, I can get a new identity if I cooperate with God. So here's Jacob and the man again. Then the man said, after he says, what's your name? I'm a liar. He says, I know, but guess what? Your name will no longer be a liar, deceiver, manipulator, but Israel, which means prince of God. Then he blessed him there. He hung on to the guy. He says, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. He blesses him, and Jacob calls the place Peniel, saying, which means face-to-face with God. It is because I saw God face-to-face. Wow. So God blesses him with a brand new identity. By the way, after he's gone through the first four stages, God blesses him with a new identity. That's what conversion is about. It's a brand new you. Let's watch this video together.
Regret. I'm pretty sure we have met. every single day of your life. I'm the whisper inside that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again till you've lost all belief.
Great reminder. Wow, you are not defined. Your name is not your worst flaw. It's not your past. It's not your addiction. It's not the trauma you experienced. And God comes to Jacob and says, your name's not deceiver, liar. It's not your biggest flaw. Your name is now Prince with God, Israel. Isn't that amazing? And by the way, he declares this to be true, even though Jacob hasn't lived another moment of his life. So he declares his new name, just like Jesus declares you righteous because he bore your sin and he gives you his goodness, his righteousness, credited to your account. He gives you a new name. I get a new identity. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness or for spiritual health, for they will be filled. Wow. And that's the transformation choice that we end with today. Transformation choices: voluntarily submit to every change God wants to make in my life and humbly ask him to remove my character defects. This is one of the steps in AA as well, by the way, just so you know. We humbly ask him to remove our character defects. We say, God, change me day at a time, moment at a time. I'm not who I was. I'm not who I'm going to be. I'm in process. We're under construction. That should be on our chests, under construction. We humbly ask him to remove those character defects. Now, conversion involves something else. And it happened to Jacob, and it's instructive for us. The sun rose as Jacob left Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. So the very thing that God used to make this guy amazing left him with a limp. Interesting. You got a limp? You got some scars? Just turns out that I have a scar And I've now had an experience that many other men can identify with. I wouldn't have been able to identify with them because I'd never had that surgery. They have. I hadn't. Now I have. And guess what? I get a bit of limp, and now I can talk to guys about their limp. God may have given you a limp already, or he's about to give you a limp because he's about to break your hip in the process of you letting him change you. But walking with a limp means something, several things. One of the first things that, well, this is what it meant for Jacob, no more running from conflict. Think about that. When you got a limp, you can't run away. And that's instructive. When God heals you, transforms you, converts you, he says, hey, no more of that conflict avoidance. We're going to be real with each other, with God and each other. Okay? Second thing it can mean is a daily reminder to trust God for strength. A daily reminder to trust God for strength. In other words, you're not as cool as you thought you were. You're not as strong as you thought you were. And it's okay. It's okay not to be okay. A daily reminder to trust God for our strength. Another thing that a limp did for David and can do for us is it's a visible reminder of our new identity. In other words, we'll never walk the same again. And that's a good thing, right? Look what Paul says in the New Testament. He says, to keep me from becoming conceited, this is Paul in the New Testament. He says, I know what Jacob was talking about, that limp. Because it turns out that I have a thorn in the flesh that torments me. Three times I pleaded with God to take away. Come here, God, take away my limp. Take away the memory of that trauma. Take away that part of my history that my last name says I'm associated with that thing in our community. Take it away, take it away, take it away. And God might be saying, no, I'm going to let you, well, I'm not going to let you have it, but I'm going to give you enough strength to manage even under that load. What feels like a curse, what feels like a thorn, what feels like a limp. I'm going to be with you because my grace is sufficient for you. Wow. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I boast about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. You might want to close with a prayer like this. I'm going to suggest it to you. You can take it home with you or think about it. Or you can pray it right now. And this is a prayer that sums up all the first five steps that we've talked about between November and now. And by the way, we just summed up the entire series to date in this message, bringing us up to date on all of these five. But now here we are, and there's a prayer that would reflect your heart if you're ready for this. Dear God, I admit I'm like Jacob. I've been struggling with you. I've been fighting with other people. I've got conflicts and stress in my life. But I don't want to get stuck at stage one in conflict with others. I certainly don't want to get stuck at stage two, a struggle with you, a crisis. So today, I'm taking these next steps. Number three, commitment. I commit myself to you, Jesus Christ, 100%. I open my life, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I give it all to you. Jesus Christ, come in, take over my life, every area. And then number four, I admit that I'm the problem. I'm not only going to admit it to you and to myself, I'm going to admit it to somebody else, somebody I trust. That thing that I've held on to, I'm going to share it with somebody so that they can pray with me and become my training partner. Please change my identity, even if I have to walk with a limp for the rest of my life. I will glory in my weakness because it shows your greatness. I pray this in your name.